Climate Northeast, which is an independent, not-for-profit partnership bringing together a whole range of stakeholders in the northeast of England to work on climate change.
En primer lugar, lo que quiero es presentar mi organización. Yo trabajo en Climate Northeast. Es una organización sin ánimo de lucro que lo que intenta es tratar todas las cuestiones relativas al cambio climático en el noreste de Inglaterra.
And Climate Northeast is slightly unusual for the rest of the UK in that our partnership supports mitigation as well as adaptation action. And we have all of our municipalities signed up to the Covenant of Mayors, so the entire northeast of England have been signatories since 2009. And we work on, like I say, both agendas, mitigation and adaptation. Most of the other partnerships in the UK work purely on adaptation. And the final point I'd like to make on this is that we are part of the Climate UK family. Back 2.5 years ago, we formed a not-for-profit company to look after the interests of all of the partnerships across the UK working on climate change. So, Northeast England, I'll just very, very quickly here, we have 4 counties. We have a different local government structure to yourselves. We only have 12 municipalities or local authorities that cover that entire area. All of those are unitary. We used to have regional levels of governance within the UK, but the current national administration has deleted all of those, so they've all gone. Okay. So how we started back, like I say, about 10 years ago, we had no detailed picture of how climate might impact the region. We had no robust emissions inventory or understanding of the policy implications for carbon emissions in the northeast.
Tampoco no teníamos.
And critically, we had no understanding of the economic implications of either the mitigation agenda or adaptation. But what we did know, what we had to deliver, was enhanced resilience of our infrastructure, our communities, our business, natural environment, and our economy to climate change, economic diversification that the whole climate scene. It's really worth looking at what is climate change adaptation. And my apologies if you are already very well versed in this, but from our perspective, adaptation is a series of measures to moderate and cope with climate change impacts. It's not a one-off activity, but continuous and incremental. So what we're looking at are what we call flexible adaptation pathways. So we could include in that physical actions, which might be raising the height of our sea walls, sea defences, flood defences and so on. It could be about increasing ventilation or cooling within buildings. But hopefully we're becoming more sophisticated now, so that's not by fitting large air conditioning units that use a great deal of electricity and power and pump out more carbon dioxide. So it's back to this integration of adaptation. And it's also about building adaptive capacity within our communities, within our local authorities, our municipalities, through raising awareness of what the impacts are likely to be, and also providing the tools and the context for decision makers. We need to make this easy for people to be able to address. If we take any climate variable, so for instance temperature, we have ups and downs, but we can draw a line through the middle of that and it gives us an approximation of climate. So for instance, if you're looking after vulnerable people in a sheltered housing scheme, you have a certain coping range, temperatures that they can cope with, and we have natural variation, and you can see that occasionally we will be moving outside of our coping range and into a point of vulnerability. Although there is uncertainty or a degree of uncertainty as to whether or not we're going to see an increase in temperatures of 2 degrees or 6 degrees, we know for sure the direction the climate is going, and effectively what that means is that we move more and more frequently into periods of vulnerability. But always between taking a decision, certainly if you work in municipalities, the public sector, there is a lag, and eventually you have your adaptation measure in, and what it does is it gives you a period of time before you start moving into vulnerability again. And as you move more and more frequently into vulnerability, you take the next step. We all like to have straight lines and certainty. Obviously, the boundaries become blurred in all of this because we're dealing with a degree of uncertainty. So before we start working on this, and there has been a great deal of work on what likely future climate is, we need to establish what our current exposure is or our level of adaptation to our current climate. So how do we go about establishing current exposure? How do we go about establishing the key vulnerabilities? Well, what we did in the UK, we used a tool called Local Climate Impact Profiles. They're very, very simple in many ways, in that we interrogate the media and historical newspapers and extract from those all of their past rainfall events or flood events or gale events and so on. We bring that together to provide data and a narrative to then discuss with service leads and asset managers across our municipalities. And that dialogue helps us to establish the sensitivity of their service to potential climate change. Northeast of England. So we carried out a piece of work that is captured within this study. All of this is available online, and you can go and have a look at how we carried out the work and the outputs. About work with our Environment Agency, which is their national environmental arm's length body for government, and Newcastle University to see whether we could put more data into the models and whether we could draw more data out. So what we managed to do was to develop this thing called EAWIG, which is the Environment Agency Regional Weather Impact Generator, horrible title, but just to see what the outputs. What we've been trying to do is to build adaptive capacity, so getting people to take this information forward and then look at it in terms of their logistics, their finances, their markets, changing demand for goods and services, their processes that they're working through, impacts on production and service delivery, people, so the implications for their workforce, customers and changing lifestyles, premises, impacts on building design, and an emerging legal imperative to address this, because climate change is now seen as being reasonably foreseeable under the law. So we're now moving on, both in the northeast and nationally, to look at the sectoral impacts and assessing those, what they mean. There has been a piece of work carried out in the UK called the National Climate Change Risk Assessment that looks at all sectors and what those key risks might be. And we're now going through the process of identifying the adaptation actions, what they could be, and to prioritise them, and then obviously key seeing them implemented. So what are the next steps for us? Well, we're continuing to support the Sustainable Energy Action Plans on the mitigation agenda and the delivery of mitigation. We are looking in the UK, our potentially Climate UK becoming a national supporting structure, because as far as I'm aware, there are only two in the UK at the moment. One is Climate North East and the Association of North East Councils, who I work with, and the other, I believe, is the EST. But we would like to see the thing to discuss with the Covenant of Mayors on this initiative is the establishment of a national supporting structure for adaptation, for Mayors Adapt, which Climate UK will be well placed, I think, to deliver, and the regional partnerships to take that forward. The resilience agenda, and resilience is a journey, not a destination.